Hello people, so today we are going to see as look a new subject, which is microprocessor 8085. So see, in microprocessor they are asking about two microprocessor mainly, 8085 and 8086. Although some topics of 8085 are there, 8086 you do not need to study, but okay, you can just study one microprocessor nicely, completely, and then the other you can study by relating it. So first we are starting with microprocessor 8085. Okay, so in UGC NET exams they are going to ask you questions, generally one or two questions from this topic, and very basic questions, they're not going in a lot of depth from this subject. So if you just look at interrupts and flags and timing diagrams, they're not asking, they're just asking from interrupts, flags, maybe instruction sets. If you just look at these topics carefully, you can get through. Okay, and this is a very nice subject, scoring subject. So I would advise that you do not leave this subject, prepare it carefully. Just go through this subject once, and since this is a very logical subject, you do not need to remember a lot of things. So this can be scoring, this can give you the extra edge. Right now we are going to look at the basic structure of the microprocessor, how the microprocessor was designed, what was the intention, how the things were placed, what were the problems faced that because of which we had to make some modifications. Microprocessor was basically made to ease the task, ease some functions, ease some arithmetic functions, logical functions, just simple functions of addition, subtraction, everything. See, you've already, you might have seen in digital electronics that we can design an adder, we can design a subtractor. But see, how many gates, how many logic circuits are you going to put on one PCB? If you have studied, you might know. There's a limitation to a PCB. The number of gates, the number of things that you can put on a PCB is limited. You cannot overcrowd it. So maybe somebody got an idea that we can some IC such that it can perform a number of arithmetic and logical operations. Arithmetic operations of addition, division, etc. Sorry, addition, subtraction. And logical operations like AND, OR, XOR. So with this idea, they designed a microprocessor. Now see what all we are going to put in the microprocessor. This is VCC and ground. These are obviously they are given for the power supply. We are going to give the power supply to the IC using this VCC and ground. Then we have put a clock. Okay, in every sequential circuit, in any circuit where synchronization is required, where you have to interface two things. We are going to interface memory with this circuit. We are going to interface some input-output devices. So that there clock is necessary. So we are putting a clock. 3 megahertz frequency clock we are going to use. Actually, this is not a clock, this is a counter. We are using a counter to provide clock to this. Okay, but for right now, you can understand that we are giving the clock to this IC. See, this is ID. ID stands for instruction decoder. Instruction decoder. What is the purpose for this? Any instruction that you are going to give to this microprocessor, your microprocessor, there should be something inside it that decodes it, that executes it, that understands it. Basically, the work of this block is to just see what instruction is given, what do you want to say. This is going to tell the microprocessor what work is to be done. This is a control and timing unit. This is just going to synchronize things when you are going to access the memory, when the input output has to be accessed, everything. This is going to be done by control and timing. This is the main part. This is the ALU. ALU is arithmetical logical unit. This is going to perform all the arithmetic operations and logical operations. This is going to have a number of adders, subtractors, AND gates, OR gates. Okay, all this is going to be here. This is the carry bit. Okay, see, whenever you are performing any arithmetic operations, you might have already seen in digital electronics that whenever we are required to perform addition or subtraction, one carry or borrow is required. So this is going to do that work. These are different registers. Okay, I have drawn only three, although this microprocessor 8085 is going to have A, B, C, D, E, 5 registers and one HL pair also. Okay, we are going to look at later. For now, you understand these are different registers. What is the work of these registers is they're going to hold some data, they're going to Okay, just hold data. Whenever you want to perform operations between data, two different data, suppose you can put one data in register B, one data in register C, and then just simply add and put the result in A. Something like that. They are just holding the data. This is the bus. What is the bus doing is, whenever you want to transfer data from memory to register, register to memory, you are going to put the data from register to this bus. This bus is going to transfer the data to the memory. Okay, fine. These are write and read lines. Okay, they are active low. Active low means whenever you make write bar 0 or read bar 0, you are going to read or write from the memory. When they are 1, memory is not being accessed. These are the address lines. Address lines, because see, I have interfaced a memory. This is a memory. Memory has been interfaced with the microprocessor. So these are the address lines. See, there has to be some locations in the memory, address of the memory. Okay, so you have, the microprocessor will have to tell what memory location exactly has to be accessed. What are you exactly looking for? So we are going to place the address on these address lines. This 8085 has 16 address lines and 8 data lines. So what is going to happen is, every location in the memory is going to have a 16-bit long address. Okay, so 16-bit long address has to be put on these address lines, and when you reach that particular address, if you want to read data or write data, this is going to be done with the help of data bus. This is having one address bus and one data bus. Okay, but what happens practically is, see, we required one address bus of 16 bits or 16 address lines. And also we required one data bus of 8 bits or 8 address lines. But see, these were a total of 24 bits or 24 lines. But whenever you are going to increase a pin in the IC, you are going to need a padding, IC padding, of course, for insulation, which is costly. So as you increase number of lines, number of bits, number of pins in the IC, you are increasing the cost of the IC. To cut the cost, to make this IC cost effective, what we do is, we are using a concept known as multiplexing of pins, pin multiplexing. What we do is, see, these eight, one important concept that you need to understand is, whenever you are giving the data, you are not extracting, whenever you are giving the address, you are not extracting data. And whenever you are extracting the data, you do not require to give the address. Using this concept, what we have done is, A15 to A8, that is the upper bits, higher bits, are only used as address lines. These comprise of only the address bus, only the address bus. And the lower 8 bits, these have been multiplexed. Okay, this is going to behave as data bus as well as address bus. Multiplexed. Okay, so what we have done using this way is, we have saved 8 pins, we have saved 8 lines. Whenever we are going to give the address, whenever we need to give the address, we are going to place the upper 8 bits in these lines, lower 8 bits in these lines. And when we reach the location, then what we are going to do is, we are going to use this as a data bus. For doing this work, we are using a special signal known as ALE. ALE stands for address latch enable. Address latch enable. Okay, what does this address latch enable do? This does what its name says exactly. It just enables a latch. Okay, latch means it is going to lock this bus for using as address only. Whenever this ALE is going to be 1, this bus is going to be used as an address bus. And whenever this ALE is 0, this bus is going to be used as a data bus. Okay, so using this ALE is basically a flip-flop. Whenever flip-flop is 1, it allows changing data. Whenever flip-flop is 0, it's going to be used as data bus. Okay, so using this ALE, we are doing pin multiplexing. Okay, till then, we can just look at the working, basic working of this microprocessor. Okay, you might not understand the instructions right now. You may not be able to get, but just listen. Suppose we have got an instruction MVIA23H and this instruction was stored at memory location 2000. Okay, see, every instruction that you are going to give is every possible instruction, every possible data has to be stored in the memory. Okay, every possible instruction, every possible data has to be stored in the memory. Plus one more thing, suppose you store this instruction in the memory. So this is a 2-byte instruction, that is going to take 2 memory locations. Each memory location can store 1 byte. So this instruction is going to take 2 bytes. So if the starting address for this instruction is 2000, this MVIA is known as opcode. We call this opcode. This is opcode. So this opcode is going to take 1 byte. This data is going to take 1 byte. Opcode 1 byte, data 1 byte. So starting address is 2000. So this opcode is going to be stored at 2000 and this data is going to be stored at 2001. So what happens is, we're going to take a look at this from the starting. You have to start a program from 2000. Now, what happens is this PC is going to hold the value 2000. PC is program counter. This does exactly what its name is. This counts the program. This is always going to tell you the address of the location that you have to go to keep the program running. So PC holds 2000. Now the value of PC is written on the address bus. Higher bits of this address are going to be written on the upper address bus. Lower bits are going to be written on lower address bus. As soon as you write this address on the address bus, we are going to make ALE as 1. As we have made ALE as 1, this multiplex bus acts as an address bus. Now we reach the address 2000. Suppose this is the memory location 2000. When you reach here, you are going to find MVIA. MVIA is going to be written here. Now, when we have reached here, we reach here in 1 clock cycle. When you have reached here, ALE is going to be 0. You are going to make ALE 0. As soon as you make ALE 0, this bus is going to act as a data bus. Now, this gets overwritten with MVIA. To read this data, we are making read bar as 0. Read bar as 0. Since this is an active low pin, you have to make it 0 so that it can read the data. This data has been read, overwritten on the data bus. Now what happens is, this is going to get here, instruction decoder. Instruction decoder gets this opcode. This is known as the opcode. This reaches the instruction decoder. Now what does this instruction decoder interpret? That something has to be moved to A register. A register is also known as accumulator. So it knows now that there is some data present in the memory location which has to be written in A, which has to be written in the accumulator. Now this instruction decoder asks for the data. Where is the data? What is the data? So that it can write in the accumulator. In the time being, when all this was happening, this PC got incremented. This PC increased its value by 1. Now the value of PC is 2001. Now 20 is going to be written here. Here 01 is going to come. ALE is again 1. Now we reach the next memory location. Suppose this was 2001H. Now we have reached 2001H. What was stored in 2001? 23 in hexadecimal. Again, ALE becomes 0, read bar becomes 0, this gets loaded with 23. Now this is going to come into the bus. This bus is going to hold 23. Already this told the microprocessor that some data is going to come and you are supposed to load it in the accumulator into register A. So this 23 gets stored in the accumulator. Okay, what is PC going to do? This is going to get incremented. Suppose some other instruction, add B, add C, something was stored. So this will be executed like this. This is how any program, any instruction is going to be executed by the microprocessor. Suppose if it was an arithmetic operation, add B, add C, add immediate data, something like that, ALU would have been involved. ALU would do the arithmetic operation. If there was a carry, this would become 1, this would become 0 accordingly. Okay, fine. Now let us look at the pin diagram. Okay, so now we are going to look at the architecture, the pin diagram of 8085 microprocessor. So basically this is a 40 pin IC, dual inline package, dual inline package DIP. That means that it is going to have pins on both sides of the IC. Okay, fine. And it is working on NMOS technology, compatible with TTL. Compatible with TTL logic. So, we can just have a look at the pins first. Okay, one more thing. We are using a 3 megahertz clock, that is operating frequency of the microprocessor is 3 megahertz, 5 volt supply. So these are some basics about the 8085 microprocessor. Now just look at the pins. This A15 to A8 is higher order address bus. We already talked about address bus, right? So these 8 pins represent the higher ordered address bus. This is lower order AD7 to AD0. This is lower order address come data bus. This is a multiplexed bus. This is going to act as address bus as well as data bus. This is address latch enable. We've also discussed the use of this ALE. If this ALE is 1, that means this is going to be used as address bus only. If this ALE is 0, this is going to be used as data bus only. This is for input output slash memory. Using this pin, you can select whether you want to work with input output or you want to work with the memory. Fine, these pins S1, S0, they tell you the status. Status means when you are writing the memory, when you are reading the memory, when you are writing the input output, reading the input output. This represents these two are active low pins. They are active low and used for reading and writing. This is read bar, write bar. This is for serial data communication. Okay, this is serial input data, this is serial output data. Now this pin ready, this is used for slow peripheral. Suppose you interfaced a slow peripheral with the microprocessor. Then whenever the slow peripheral is ready, whenever it is ready to be interfaced, ready to be used, it is going to give this signal. This is used for interfacing slow peripheral. Then these are some interrupts. TRAP, RST 7.5, 6.5, 5.5, INTR, that is interrupt, and this is interrupt acknowledgement. These are some interrupts. Okay, we are going to learn interrupts later. Okay, these two pins, hold and hold acknowledge, they are used for direct memory access. Direct memory access, DMA. Okay, we are going to learn about DMA also. What happens in DMA is, if somebody needs to use the buses of the microprocessor for transferring data between memory and some external device, microprocessor is not involved, then we are going to use these pins, hold and hold acknowledge, so that buses can be allotted to the third device for use, memory can be allotted. Okay, we are using it. Then this is a reset in bar, this is active low pin, this is reset out. Okay, whenever you want to reset the microprocessor, you can use this pin. This is clock out. This is if you are interfacing a device, some device that does not has its own clock and you want to synchronize it with the microprocessor, we can use this clock out. Okay, microprocessor will give out the clock, it will synchronize it. This VCC ground are used to give the supply of 5 volts and this is the clock. Okay, this is the clock X1, X2. This is a clock of 3 megahertz frequencies which we are using for the 8085 microprocessor. Okay, 8085 is a 8-bit microprocessor. It is a 8-bit microprocessor, which means that the size of registers of 8085 is going to be 8 bits. Size of ALU is going to be 8 bits. It is having 16 address lines. Okay, also size of data that can be stored in any memory location is going to be 8 bit. So 8 bit microprocessor is going to have registers of size 8 bit, ALU of size 8 bit, 16 address lines this microprocessor is having, and since it is having 16 address lines, size of program counter, we discussed about program counter, the one which holds the address of the next instruction to be executed. Okay, the work of program counter is to hold the address of the next instruction to be executed. So size of program counter is obviously going to be 16 bits. Okay, now we are going to discuss the size of memory. Size of memory that can be interfaced with 8085 microprocessor. I'm going to have a look quickly. Size memory. Since size of each memory address, size of each memory address is 16 bits, right? We are having 16 address lines, therefore size of each memory address is going to be 16 bits. Therefore, total number of memory locations, total number of memory locations that are present is 2 to the power 16, total 2 to the power 16 memory locations are present. Also number of bits that can be stored, number of bits that can be stored at each memory location, at each memory location is 8 bits. Okay, each data that we are going to store at any memory location is having 8 bits. So size of memory is going to be 2 to the power 16 memory locations are there, and then you can store 8 bits in one location. So this is going to be the total size of memory, total usable memory. Suppose, I can write it like this, right? 2 to the power 6 is 64. This 2 to the power 10 can be written as 1 kilo and 8 bits make 1 byte. So size of memory of 8085 microprocessor is going to be 64 kilobytes. This is going to be the total usable size of memory.